Hey, Coach, man, what time is it?
Oh, Slim, you know what time it is. 6 o'clock, straight up and down. It's Homespun Sports with Coach John Montgomery. Sports talk with a twist of down-home wisdom. Hey, welcome once again. You've tuned into Homespun Sports. Is sports dog with just a little twist of down home wisdom. I am your host, the coach, John W. Montgomery, the second back home to kinfolk and friend, call me John too. But I'm right here in good old H-Town, Houston, Texas. My ride or die, last pee in the shell, my show now, baby. Boy, what's up, Mildred Marini Montgomery? What's up, my man? What's up?
How you doing, coach? How you doing, man?
Man, full of fluid, ready to do it because I'm used to it, man. This is season number 5, show number 2, and we could not do it in more grand style than we are right now with our very special guest, the head football coach at my alma mater, your pawpaw's alma mater, Prairie View A&M. And without any further ado, ladies and gentlemen, please make welcome Bubba McDowell.
You know.
What's up, man? Back to back reunion shows to open up season 5, Coach. Thank you for coming on again, man. Thank you for coming on again.
Anytime you guys call, you know, I'm there if possible.
Man, Bubba, we sure enough do appreciate it, man. You are leading and guiding a football program that is dear to my heart. You know, my father. All-American there in 1939, and I wasn't near about the player he was, but man, 1972, 3, 4, and 5, I practiced on the practice field and played at Blackshear Field. And so, man, to have you here with us, man, we're just honored, Bubba, man. We're just so grateful, man. I know you're busy, man.
Yeah. I'm looking out the window now. They down there. You know, I got one of the coaches talking on my back.
Okay.
We ain't gonna hold you, Coach. We ain't gonna hold you. But, Coach, big talk in camp. You're 11 practices in. Big talk is there's a 3-way battle for the starting QB job. What's your take on that?
Is it ever? And that's a good thing. I don't think I've had that since I've been here. This is my 13th year. I don't think I've had a battle like this with 3 guys. Okay. Particular time going into this season, man, and they all are doing very, very well. Heck, my freshman, you know, from Fulcher, he's doing really well. But you know, we're gonna have to sit him down because we've got three-headed monsters in front of him right now. So they're doing really well.
Okay. And you 11 practices in, Bubba. You ready to give a little sneak input as to who these guys are and where they come from?
Well, Cam Peters, you know, again, Cam was at UIW for a minute. We actually tried to get him coming out, went to UIW. Now he's back with us. Lucas Cooley, by way of Arkansas to U of H. I guess when the coach got fired there, we got a chance to talk with him. Some guys knew of his contact people. And we made contact with him. We stayed on him. You know, he came out, took a visit, really liked what we was about. You know, and again, he knew that we was going to get Cam. We knew that we had Jaden Johnson, you know, bounced back from Ole Miss and then went to Jones College and, you know, did pretty well then. Now, Jaden, again, was going to compete with Trezon last year. But Jaden, right before the TSU game, we got message that he was ineligible to play due to some circumstances. So he had to sit out that whole year, you know, and now he's back. You know, he's competing, you know, and again, I guarantee you, now, had he had a chance to play last year, you know, he probably, you know, gave Trezon a good run. We probably most likely would have been using 2 different guys, you know, in certain situations because they both, you know, of course, you guys know about Trezon, but Jaden, again, he's that type of dude. So, again, got three good battles going, man, with these young men. So, you know, and the great thing about it, Jay, you know, they like it, man. We have no qualms. Yeah. And that's one of the biggest questions I got. So who's out there arguing, who's taking on the pity part? Neither one of them. They know what's
okay.
I mean, you know, they're trying to win that job, you know. Hopefully by the end of next week, we'll know exactly who we're going to go with.
Good deal.
So, Coach, look, we're not fit to ignore the elephant in the room, all right? I'm up against two PV guys right here, okay?
He went to TSU. He went to TSU, see?
Yeah, well, where he coaching at right now, Coach? Where is he coaching, okay? The Labor Day Classic, Coach. Prairie View versus Texas A&M.
Texas Southern,
excuse me. Now, for the past nine seasons, you've been 9-0, perfect in this game. How do you get your players emotionally prepared to face a team that they've almost beaten 10 times in a row?
Yeah, and they gotta understand, again, it's not, they don't look at the number nine, they look at the number one.
You know, that's what I'm talking about.
It's one game. It's one game that we got to win. That's the first game, and they know without a doubt. You know, hey, Ben starting off with this team. You know, Ben had close game with them in the past. That's the past, and that's every year. That's what I try to get them to understand. Hey, the past is a past. We're starting off one game, so we want to go. You know, and they have built up that mentality every year. You know, since I've been here, and hopefully again. You know, I'm going to tell them the exact same thing. You know, don't worry about the number nine or where we at. You know, guys, you know what we have done against TSU. You know, it's been some close games, close battles. But now, understanding, that's in the past. We got to go get one, be 1-0 by the end of this guy game on the 31st.
You know what, Bubba, you hit on a key point and you're spot on correct, my brother, because let me tell you something. Anytime you done whoop somebody 9 years in a row, the opponent is yourself. Mm-hmm. So it's all about playing. You won the West last year. So right. It's all about playing like Prairie View. You play like Prairie View, the rest of it gonna fall in line.
Absolutely. And again, they know that. Because they know again, it's a conference game. Sure. It's very hard anyway in the West, as you guys know, man. So you know, we gotta get off with a good start with these guys.
Absolutely, Coach. Now, Coach, the transfer portal. It's the new wave of college football, right? Everybody's doing the transfer portal. How did Prairie View navigate the transfer portal last season or this offseason?
Well, yeah, we hit it hard. We did hit it hard. And again, we you know, it's a monster, man. I'm just be honest with you. It's a monster trying to navigate through that ordeal, through that transfer portal. Because again, you know, now you got kids that are coming in. You know, first thing they ask you, like, Coach, what do you got for me? That's the first thing come out their mouth, Coach. And I'm like, oh, well, I ain't got nothing for you right now, but what I can offer you, you know, come in, get some great teaching, and hopefully get, you know, win the Western Conference and get to the Celebration Bowl. That's what I have right now. But again, it's all about money with these kids right now. And again, as I tell coaches, you got to go out, find out what this kid about, find out who his contact person is, who is in his camp. We got to talk to them, you know, and try to get them here. Because a lot of times what we do is we try to sell them to get to campus. And once we get to campus, like Cooley did with Lucas, you know, we got them.
Yeah, I hear you, man. It you know, the thing is apropos the name, Prairie View. It's serene. When I went to school there, you had to be careful on Highway 290 driving back and forth to Houston for deer and wild pigs. But hell, Houston has grown almost out to Prairie View. It's four lane coming and going, but it's serene out there, pristine out there, beautiful campus, and that stadium. Oh man, and that locker room, Bubba, that locker room, man, that is big time.
Justice, man.
Great facility. We always think that, again, we can get these young men, whether they're a transfer portal kid or a high school kid coming out, you know, we got a really, really good chance of landing these guys. You know, again, as we talked about the portal earlier, you know, it is what it is. You know, we're going to have to go to them at some point, you know, get what we need out of it. But for the most part, you know, I'm trying to build build off a high school guys. But, again, it's hard to do with the transfer portal being how it is these days.
Mm-hmm. Well, Bubba, man, listen, we do appreciate this, man. I know you got camp going on, and like I said,
back at it.
You got to get back at it. And it, okay, all right. Wow, man, man. Prayer View. Dear Prayer Review, our song to thee we raise. In gratitude, we sing our hymn of praise. Man.
Back to back. Back to back reunion shows, Coach. Yeah, that's big time,
yeah.
Man.
Yeah, that's big time. That's big time. It's Bubba McDowell, man. He got that football program going in the right direction. And I'm expecting big things out of Prairie View A&M for the 2024 season. No question about it.
I'm expecting history to not repeat itself, but yeah.
well, that's a whole nother story. That's a whole nother story. Slim, man. Man, just wrapped up the Olympics, my brother, and wow, what an athletic exhibition. What was your Olympic moment?
Coach, I'm a basketball man, man. You know me. We've had the dream teams. We've had, you know, good runs with the U.S. basketball team, but I think my Olympic moment was LeBron James and Steph Curry's team up to overcome France and get that gold medal. When that reporter asked LeBron, what name would you give this Olympic team? And he said, the Avengers.
Okay.
I was like, yeah, I like that.
And Steph Curry hit that shot, man.
Man, but that's Steph, though. But that's Steph, Coach. What was your Olympic moment, Coach?
Slim, there were several, man. You know that dude that won the silver medal in the high jump, go to Wheeler Avenue. And can't call his name, but he go to Wheeler Avenue. And of course, Simone Biles and what she accomplished, and those three black women on the podium at one time for that women's Olympic team. That's unprecedented, that never happened before. But I think at the end of the day, Slim, the heart and the competitiveness that boy Noah Lyles showed. But Slim, think about this. Test positive for COVID on Tuesday. Yeah. Didn't tell a soul. Didn't say a word. Went and quarantined himself. Already had the gold medal in his pocket. Won the gold in the 100 meters. Already know he done won the title of world's fastest human. All right? Mm-hmm. But this brother goes and quarantines himself without telling anybody and participates in the 200 meter trying to pull the doubles. You know, that's rare. That's rare territory. We're talking Bob Hayes and Carl Lewis, you know, that's rare territory. But it was very obvious as he finished third and won the bronze, when he crossed that finish line, it was very obvious something was wrong with that brother. And come to find out, he had COVID. Yeah. And Slim, they had to put him in a wheelchair to get him off the track. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's hard.
Giving it your all, man.
Oh, come on, man. That's landing on the line for your country right there. No question, man. So that was probably my Olympic moment.
Oh, well, it looks like we got guests. How you doing, sir? What's your name?
I'm Monty, the Magnificent. I can fix anything from a broken heart to the break of day. People travel across continents just to hear what I have to say. I'm a Monty the Magnificent. And I have in my hand sealed answers that I will answer, that I will reveal to the audience before I open these hermetically sealed envelopes. Are you ready?
I'm ready, Monty.
Bill Belichick. The next head football coach of the New York Giants.
What?
Okay.
Slim, their schedule, they open up at home against the Minnesota Vikings. Okay. Kevin O'Donnell has a better roster than the New York Giants. And while it's at home, he's got Justin Jefferson at the wide out. That's a better roster, okay? They got that Addison kid that they took in the first. I'm talking about the Minnesota Vikings. They got that Addison kid that they took from USC. It's a more explosive offense. It's a better roster than the Giants. Okay. The second game, the Giants go on the road and take on at Washington. Okay. Dan Quinn, newly hired head coach, and they got the Heisman Trophy winner, Jaden Daniels from LSU last year, and he's tearing it up. Did you see him Saturday night in the exhibition game? That boy Jaden Daniels can play. The Washington Commanders have two interior first round picks. It's a better roster. They're 0-2 when they're on the third game. They go to Cleveland. Kevin Stefanski, head football coach, and they got Deshaun Watson and Amari Cooper. That's three losses. They come home for the fourth game and they play at Dallas. Clem, it's a good chance that the New York Giants will be 0-4. And oh yeah, by the way, in the fifth game, they go to Seattle. Okay?
Why do you say Bill Belichick will be the next head coach for the Giants?
Well, the last time the Giants were good, Bill Parcells was the head coach. They won two Super Bowls under Bill Parcells. Now, who was the defensive coordinator when Bill Parcells won those two Super Bowls?
It was Bill Belichick, Monty.
Bingo. The New York Giants organization loves Bill Belichick. And as our good and dear friend Doug Williams always says, the NFL is all about marketing. And let me tell you, hey, Sam, Bill Belichick has done everything you can do in pro football. He's won six Super Bowls. Okay? The only thing that he has left, he's 15 wins shy of eclipsing Don Shula. Don Shula has 347 wins. Bill Belichick has 333. And thank you very much. Okay? Mm-hmm. And you can rest assured that he will be head coach on somebody's sideline for the 2025 season. Gonna set this one out. I get it. But Bill Belichick gonna be a head coach again in the NFL, and I think it'll be at the New York Giants. I certainly do. No question in my mind. So you ready for the second one?
I'm ready, Coach. Monty, excuse me.
The second one is. I'm Monty. I'm not Coach. I'm Monty. Monty the Magnificent. The haters will have to wait until 2025. Did you hear me?
I heard you, Coach.
I said the haters will have to wait until 2025. I'm going to tell you why right now. Just a second. Get your damn envelope open. Okay. First time Monty done this, but okay. All right. Here we go. Because Deion Sanders and the Colorado Buffaloes will be bowl eligible by the end of the 2024 season. And you can count on that. You can count on that, Slim. Remember, you heard it right here from Monty the Magnificent.
All right. Absolutely. I like that, Coach. Well, Coach, you ought to be. I mean, you got Shedeur Sanders, definitely going to be a first-round pick next year, and you got probably the greatest two-way in college football in Travis Hunter.
And no question. And Sam, listen, don't forget now, at the conclusion of the 2022 season, I'm talking about the CFP, TCU lost in the national championship game in the 2022 season. And Deion Sanders, a newly hired staff, okay, a bunch of players that nobody knew about. He had fall camp to get that whole organization together, and they went to Amon Carter Stadium on TCU
and kicked his ass. Yep. And listen, nobody saw that coming. Now, I get it. This year, he's put together 42 new faces. More than any other team in the transfer portal, Colorado brought in 42 players. But, as you said, he has a Heisman Trophy finalist at quarterback, who will be a first-round pick. He has a Heisman Trophy finalist in Travis Hunter, who's the best two-way player in college football. The big key with Colorado is, can that offensive line gel? I think they will. And so I have him hanging on and finding a way to beat North Dakota State. They go on the road, beat Nebraska. He beat them last year. They go on the road and beat Colorado State, beat them last year. And Slim, Monty the Magnificent, predicts that they'll be 3-0 when they take on Colorado at home in Folsom Field on September the 21st. And if he is, Slim, Colorado going to be 4-0. And if they 4-0 in 2025, if you thought college football was buzzing last year over the start of Deion Sanders, you wait to what he does this year. Remember where you heard it. You got
all right,
it,
Monty.
Monty.
All right, Monty. I like that all one. Right. I like that one. You got another one for me?
I got one more if I can pick it up off the floor. Yeah. I got one more. First time we've done this. Okay. All right. And this is the last one.
Just got out there a little bit. I see it. All right.
I got it. Able, hear me? Can you hear me? Mm-hmm. Able to hear a mouse piss on drunk stove cotton.
It's gonna be like an ability, coach. Like what?
The ability to hear a mouse piss on drugstore cotton.
Okay.
And that is what you will be able to do if you are in attendance at the Gaylord, at the Oklahoma Gaylord Memorial Stadium. If you're one of the 80,126 spectators who are taking in the game and standing in awe as the University of Oklahoma Sooners struggle, and Slim, they could lose that football game on September the, what's the date of the OU, University of Houston football game, Slim?
Monty, September the 7th.
September the 7th. Slim, they could lose that football game. And I said it all along, OU is going to struggle when they go to the SEC, and you'll know just how good the Sooners will be in 2024 as they take on the University of Houston. Slim, Willie Fritz is a hell of a coach, and he will not be intimidated by the University of Oklahoma. Believe that. Willie Fritz was the head coach at Tulane last year. Mm-hmm. Tulane went 12-2 last year. Slim, Willie Fritz and the Tulane Green Wave beat Southern Cal in a bowl game.
Yeah, coach.
Okay? Now, the big thing, Slim, is for the Oklahoma fans, and I said it before, how good is OU at the halfway point? Okay? Because that's Slim. They got
back
schedule.
In.
Well, Slim, listen. Let's chop that thing up, boy. Let's chop that thing up. They open up with Temple. That's a win. Okay? Mm-hmm. Now, even if you give them U of H in the second game, talking about Houston, the Cougars of Houston, even if you give them that game, okay, they're 2-0? Huh? 2-0?
I say that, coach. I say that.
All right. Then the third game is Tulane. Okay?
I say they win Tulane.
They went Tulane. That's better than my son speaking of Tulane. When Willie Fritz was still the head coach at Tulane in the 2021 season, OU struggled to beat Tulane. They hung on to beat them 40-35. But you're giving them that game.
I'm giving them that game.
Then the fourth game, they got who? Tennessee Vols, right?
Yeah.
Tennessee Vols. Josh Heupel. OU quarterback, won the national championship there under Bob Stoops in 2000. He comes back to OU and whoops their ass in front of God and everybody. They're going to get a whipping against Tennessee. You heard it right here. Then they go on the road. Then they go on the road to Auburn, right?
Auburn, right.
They go on the road to Auburn. Now, Hugh Freeze going to have a good football team. And more than that, Hugh Freeze got to win.
He needs to win.
And Slim, I got Auburn whipping them.
Same, okay.
All right. Now, they got an open week after that. Is that correct? You look at the schedule?
That's right, Coach.
They got an open week. Then they got Red River Rivalry. Okay? They got the Red River Rivalry. And listen, any way you chop it up, the top four teams, and we're going to get to it in college football, in any particular order, Georgia, Ohio State, Oregon, and Texas. Okay? In any particular order, Texas is one of the top four teams in the country. And they will whip OU this year like they stole a ham from Kroger. Remember where you heard it. So at the halfway point, and I said it before, I say it again. If Oklahoma has any chance of making it to the CFP, what's their record at the halfway point? They need to be at minimum 5-1 at the halfway point. If they have any chance at making the CFP, okay?
That ain't happening, Coach.
Because the back end, as you said, is pure hell. Because on the second half of that schedule, Shane Beamer and the South Carolina Gamecocks come to town. That's a win. Shane Beamer got a win anyway, and that team ain't that good. They'll beat South Carolina. So that's a win, okay?
They had an Ole Miss.
Then they go to the Grove, all right? Ole Miss is ranked 6th in the Football Coaches Association poll and in the Associated Press poll. A lot of people think that Lane Kiffin's roster this year is good enough to meet up with Kirby Smart in Atlanta in the SEC championship game. Okay? This is a very good Ole Miss team.
So they play Maine, Coach.
That's a gimme. That's a one double A team. It shouldn't even be there, but it's homecoming. I get it. All right, they win it. So at this point, OU, if you're right about Houston, let's go back. If you're right about Houston, they beat Temple, they beat Houston, they beat Tulane. They don't win again until they get to South Carolina. That's 4.
Yeah.
They beat Maine, that's 5. All right?
All right.
After Maine, they go to Missouri, correct?
Yeah.
Missouri beat Ohio State last year in the bowl game. Held Ohio State to 3 points. Okay? And it's in Columbia. And then they come home and they play the Crimson Tide of Alabama. Hello. Now, if they can't beat Missouri in Columbia, you think there's any chance in hell they're gonna beat Alabama in Norman? Get real.
Then they end the season with LSU in Death Valley.
At night. Okay?
Nah.
Okay.
Nah.
Slim. Make no mistake about it. And I grew up in Oklahoma, okay? Talked to my good friend Joe Washington just the other day. He's agreed to come on the show. We're going to have him on the show, incidentally. But let me just say this. The days of Oklahoma glory, if you're not very careful, you could see the Sooners of Oklahoma. You know, Slim, how a caterpillar morph into a butterfly?
Mm-hmm.
You could see the University of Oklahoma morph into the Arkansas Razorbacks. By that, I mean a team that goes to camp just happy as hell to win 8, maybe 9 games because of one simple thing. Location. My brother, understand that even in his glory days, Barry Switzer was whipping the likes of Iowa State, Kansas State. Homeboy, them days are over. You now going to Africa. LSU, Louisiana, Tuscaloosa, Alabama, Athens, Georgia, Tennessee, Africa.
Gainesville, Florida.
Thank you. The SEC is Africa. And on location, Texas is much more better suited to compete in the SEC. for crying out loud. You can't get no more Africa than Dallas, Houston, Longview, Marshall, Kilgore, Lufkin. You can't Henderson, Texas. Thank you. You can't get no more. And I said, listen, why do you think Lincoln?
Lincoln Riley, why do you think he left, coach?
And look where he went.
L.A.
L.A. slash what?
Africa.
I didn't hear you. Say it again.
Africa for the Africa.
Good black talent in Los Angeles, California. And Lincoln Riley saw it coming. Hold on. One more point, Sam, when we move on. One more point. Why do you think Brian Kelly, and here is a Irish Catholic white man, okay, mm-hmm. who said Notre Dame is my dream job. It's my dream job. And he did a hell of a job coaching at Notre Dame.
Yeah, coach.
Got Notre Dame.
National championship game in 2013. Lost to Alabama 42-14. Got in 2018. Lost 30-3 to Clemson. I mean, man, that kind of, yeah.
Slim, Alabama bust his head open down to the white meat. Why do you think he left? And when he left, where did he go?
Coach, he left because he had taken Notre Dame as far as they could go. And when he left, he went to Baton Rouge, Louisiana.
Africa. When he left, he went to Africa. Now, Slim, don't you think it's just a little ironic? Not even ironic. Why do you think Notre Dame hired Marcus Freeman? Hello. Why do you think Notre Dame hired Marcus Freeman? Huh? Because they are hoping that Marcus Freeman can bring enough Africa to South Bend, Indiana, and do what Brian Kelly couldn't. Bottom line. Slim, let me tell you, man, it's been a ball.
Nice, coach. That was good with Monty. Monty. I'm really going to have to get used
Monty.
To that.
The magnificent.
I hope we get to see you again, Monty. I really hope we do, man. This has been nice. All right, Monty. All right. So, coach, good to see you, man.
Good to see you. Hey,
glad to get back. Man, I thought Monty was going to be here forever, man.
Man, you know, Monty just stop in for a little brief time. Maybe he might come back.
I got you.
Yeah, Monty might be back. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, coach, college football, the AP polls came out top 25. I know you saw them. Let's break down this top 10, though.
All right, man. You know, Slim, I think it's very. I think it's an accurate top 10. No question. They're identical until you get down to 8 and 9, and they just flip.
Yeah,
the coaches poll has Michigan 8. The AP poll has Penn State 8. The coaches poll has Penn State 9. The college poll has Michigan 9. So, you know, other than that, Florida State 10 on both of them. Yeah, no question. Well, you know, and Slim, I think it's a very accurate poll. Some good coaches on heading up these rosters. And it's going to be a race, man. I'm going to tell you something, man. And I know it's a 12-team bracket this year in the CFP. But
it's new, man.
You better have your helmet screwed on real tight because come with it this season, because there's some good teams, man. I think the consensus is the top four teams are Georgia, Ohio State, Oregon and Texas.
Yeah.
No question. But Slim, you got Alabama sitting right there at 5. And Slim, Alabama got the best quarterback of them other four.
I'm about to say that's why they like it at 5, coach. They like it at 5 because they understand that they know they got a better quarterback than Quinn Ewers at Texas. They know they got a better quarterback than Dylan Gabriel at Oregon, Will Howard at Ohio State, and Carson Beck at Georgia. Yeah, I'm taking Jalen Milroe all day.
I am absolutely, too. I'm going to tell you something, too, Clem. The more you study up on this boy, Kalen DeBoer, Kalen DeBoer at Alabama. Mm-hmm.
Kalen DeBoer, yes.
Yeah,
he's Slim. A winner, coach.
Hey. You think at Sioux Falls
won national title.
Listen, hey Slim,
He was 67-3. That's NAIA football, Slim. I'm gonna tell you something. I coached at Langston. That's NAIA. Slim, you were 67-3 in NAIA football, bro. You coach,
man.
Slim, he was 25-3 at Washington. This boy can coach, Slim.
Coach, that was his first in his first year. He inherited a 4-8 Washington Husky program in his first year. Took them to 11-2.
Well, I'm just trying to tell you, man.
Beat Texas. Lost them and lost to Michigan in this in the national championship.
I'm telling you, this boy carrying the board about it, and I'm real going to pay very close attention to watch how he progresses and coaches this boy, Jalen Milroe, and gets him ready to play in the National Football League. So yeah, I like them right where they are, Slim. I sure do. I sure do. And we talked about it earlier, Slim, that this boy. A lot of people think that the dark horse in the CFP race is Lane Kiffin and his Ole Miss Rebels. A lot of people think that. So I'm looking for them to be very competitive. You know, you got Notre Dame sitting right there. And again, and Slim, we're going to talk about this a little bit later on, big games. But Marcus Freeman in his third year, okay, he's 19-8. He's got to get them over that threshold, Mildred. He has got to, because that's why they brought him there. That's why they brought him now, Slim. Let's not kid ourselves now. You know, a black man get the Notre Dame job, he can't be average. No way, no how. No way, no how. I had a good friend of mine. Good friend of mine, a hell of a football coach, a guy by the name of Tyrone Willingham, had that job and started off bang at Notre Dame, winning, won big. Toward the end, got to losing to Brigham Young. You know, hell no. No, you can't do that. Not be black and head coach at Notre Dame and losing to Brigham Young. Get your ass. No, you can't be average.
Speaking of Marcus Freeman, coach, they open up the season with Texas A&M. They go to Aggieland and they take on Texas A&M.
They
that's
do.
A big test for them right there, coach. I still have Notre Dame, but watch out for the Aggies, though.
Listen, that boy Mike Elko at Texas A&M ain't no joke. And Jimbo Fisher left that team with a lot of talent. Texas A&M will be talented, I'll tell you. Yeah, that's going to be a hell of a football game. I'm pulling for Marcus Freeman. That's a game Notre Dame needs to win, no question about it. No question about it. Slim, but when we get to that, it's a couple of HBCU games that I think are very important.
Got to.
Early games.
Florida A&M, new head football coach, James Cozy.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, takes over from FAMU and opens with Norfolk State. Then takes on South Carolina State August 31st.
That's right. My good and dear friend, frat brother, Rube Chisbury. But I think, Mildred, that first place, Dawson Odoms at Norfolk State got to win. Okay, Dawson Odom got to win. Okay, he's been there 4 years. He's got to win. And they go to Bragg Stadium on the campus of Florida A&M. That's a game that Florida A&M should win, but Dawson Odom needs to win. Okay, because his fanny getting warm, buddy. I promise you.
Yeah.
All right. So then the week after that, on the 31st of August, they host the South Carolina State Bulldogs. And I'm telling you, Mildred, Chinnis Berry can coach, okay? Chinnis Berry won 11 games 2 years in a row at Benedict College. Come on, man.
We spent a lot of time there, coach. You win 11 games back-to-back at Benedict, you can coach.
Ain't no question about it. And everything that I'm seeing and hearing from this brother at South Carolina State makes me think he's about to do the same thing. I think South Carolina State's up and coming. That's a football program steeped in tradition, and I would not surprise me if Chinnis Berry took them South Carolina State Bulldogs to Tallahassee and beat Florida A&M. That would not surprise me, no question about it.
I'm about to say, Coach, it's been a pleasure being in the studio with you.
All right,
but we got to wrap it up, man.
We got to wrap it up, man. Okay,
tell my lover, okay.
I'll do just that, my brother, and tell Earl Wub up in Oklahoma City that old pawpaw say, hey, okay? Would you do that?
Will do, coach. I will. I got
much
you.
Love.
Much love, player. Much love. Much love. And finally, we're going to do something about this transfer portal and this NIL business, because it's like a forest fire, ablaze and out of control. It's taken one key word out of the development of young men. Commitment. It's gone now. Okay? You're going to commit, sign. You got to change that. I don't care. When you commit, sign. Okay? Okay? You commit, ain't no more visits. Sign. Sign the damn letter of intent. Okay? Because at the end of the day right now with this NIL stuff, it's all about money, 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 money. Okay? And that is taking the word commitment out. And we're talking about future husbands and fathers. And that's cool, because it's nothing but free agency. That's all college football now is turned into, free agency. How much money? Okay? And that's cool for the NFL, because we're talking about grown men in their 20s and 30s, and some of them in their 40s. But these 18, 19-year-olds talking about how much? Now? Are you kidding me? What's going to happen when you get out here in the real world and you go to your job and they put a pink slip on your desk? Okay? The word commitment, it's gone. So we're going to do something about it. Nick Saban saw that, and that's why he said, deuces, I'm out of here. Got to fix that before it's too late. And hey, that's how I see it. 6 o'clock, straight up and down.
Man, that's how we see it, and that's how it is. Thank God we get to do this again. Thank y'all for tuning into this week's episode of Homespun Sports. Sports talk with a twist. Up down, home, wisdom. Y'all make sure y'all stay updated on these episodes. We are dropping content on a daily. Make sure you stay updated. It's going to be on YouTube. It's going to be on Instagram. It's going to be on Twitter. It's going to be on TikTok. Wherever you get your social media, your news, your music, your wherever in the morning, make sure y'all check that. It's going to be on Homespun Sports all day, all the time. Coach,
what you say?
I'm going to get up out of here, man.
What he said?